What's happening, Peter? What's happening?
Nothing much. Are we recording?
Yeah.
What's going on?
Yeah, I double checked this time.
What's happening, the DUTCHCAST fans out there?
What's happening? Thursday night, number 7, episode 7. Yep. I sent a bunch of links out. We'll see who pops in, who decides to grace us with their presence. Content is content, yep. Man.
Cheers.
Cheers.
I don't have a single. This is all I had, but I have a winter lager. It's delicious.
Oh, it's got the gold label now. Mm. They changed it.
Matches my shirt.
I like that label.
Yeah, I like when it's cold enough outside that you can just keep your beers on the deck.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Or in the garage. Yeah. I keep mine in the garage.
Yeah. It's just, I mean, it's not super cold here, but it's had colder days, and then it hasn't had a warmer day. So sometimes it's probably nice and frosty. Other times it's probably, you know, okay, but it's not going bad. It's not New England, but it's not going bad, you know?
Yeah, well, it was like 60 here the other day, dude.
Yeah.
60 on like December 6th. Not complaining, but I don't know, a little concerned about the ice caps, about the polar ice caps.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know, man.
No, I just wanted to hop on because I had like a shitty day today. I want to like not think about shit. And talk about
me too.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Hey, customer.
Stop.
What's up, dude? GT. Thanks for stopping by.
Did Pete get a new mic? Cause I cannot be on here.
Pete is full iPhone tonight and it sounds
full
amazing.
Anymore. I can't do it. beautiful quality, Pete, huh?
Yeah. This is the iPhone 14 Pro.
Nice.
I got the brand new iPhone switched up from an iPhone 8, and the guy at Verizon was like, "Are you sure you can handle this?" Almost smacked the teenager in the face.
Oh, it's like that.
He was just giving you shit, just that, like you're.
It's like Johnny Utah going to buy a surfboard from the surf shop, and the young kid behind the counter is like, "Yo, man, a lot of guys your age are starting to surf. That's awesome, dude."
Yeah, something like that happened.
Yeah. Oh man, you got a single, Bri?
I got a single Jack Savvy Framingham House Lager.
You got a single. You got 6 right next to you, guaranteed.
Two. One more after this. Pistol drinking the winter, Sam.
Winter.
Dude, the cover of it just looks terrible. The October.
I kind of like the gold. I kind of like the gold.
This is
label.
Great. The winter is okay, but the... Yeah.
And then I have this.
Oh, pistol. That's what I'm talking about. The redemption or the bullet.
This is from Colin's podcast. I know that he likes bourbon, so had some bourbon on that one.
That's that the rye, right?
Yeah, this is rye.
It's a good one,
it's
man.
It's good. I might have a little swig. It's good.
Please do.
Bullet is amazing whiskey, but they do hate the gays.
Okay,
you guys do they? They're hey, you guys keep cutting out
straight and straight American rye.
Yeah,
is it my internet connection? You guys cut out a few times already.
Everything's good on this end. You've cut out a couple times, Bri.
I appreciate that. I just started that.
So, what are you guys doing tonight? What happened today? Anything crazy happened today? Pete, you said you had kind of a shitty day.
I just had shitty customers and shitty business people being shitty, and I was just like over it. I wasn't over it. That's why I wanted to be over it. That's why I wanted to fucking have this talk. But mm-hmm. I'm good, man. I just put the kid to bed. I have exciting news.
We had
our first ultrasound 2 days ago. We got number 2 on the way. And baby's healthy.
Get
so
out of here. Why don't you say something?
Now. What's that?
Yeah, what's that?
No, I'm saying why don't you tell us? Well, I'm lagging behind.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably you, Bri.
I wonder, yeah, maybe I'll plug in the Ethernet and see if that does anything for
Ethernet,
me.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Well, I mean, I work up here all day.
So, Pete, do you guys know the gender yet? Or do you want to know the gender? Or
we do, but you don't get that for
trans.
20 weeks, 18 to 20 weeks. I mean, you can get blood work done and figure out what's going on there chromosome-wise. But, you know, this day and age, you don't know the gender until they're 18.
Not funny, Tennessee.
I don't care what you call yourself.
In Tennessee, hysterical.
Definitely funny.
I don't know who you're hanging out with now, Pete. I thought you're...
Woke?
You're a man of God. Oh, that actually makes sense. You're a man of God.
No. Yeah.
I'll just at your guys' stomping grounds, G Willikers with Jakey Balls.
Oh, G Willikers.
Yeah, still the spot. Well, it's like one of the only bars that does Wachusett Country on tap.
Yeah, it's that and the Boynton are the only places I've found around us that.
Mm-hmm. Which is a bummer, and most of the liquor stores don't sell it anymore, too.
Thankfully, my little neighborhood liquor store sells it. I buy it all the time.
Down in East Brookfield?
West.
West. Oh, yeah. The other part of the world.
It's getting there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How was the crowd at Vincent's this week compared to when Texas Red Hot?
Like, definitely at least half, like, people weren't there. But it was good. It was good. We had a fucking heckler of a lady in the crowd, though. Even over our, like, softest ballad, she was, woo! I'm in, boo! Like, while we're
like
just trying to...
Like, enjoying it?
Just drunk and belligerent having no respect for the music or the crowd trying to enjoy the music. Or every once in a while, you get a freaking live one, dude. You get a live wire.
Mm-hmm.
And where I would usually be the person to like kind of call them out on it or put them in their place, my bass player, Peter, 66 years old, dude. He's been through 4 marriages. He doesn't care, dude. He'll come right out and say, shut the fuck up, dude. Shut up. So that makes it easier for me, dude.
Was she into it, though? It sounds like she was kind of pumped up for the tunes.
I mean, she does it to a point where, like, she's, like, seems like she's getting off on it. Like,
mm-hmm.
Because the whole rest of the bar is, like, pretty quiet and respectful, and she's, like, yelling and clapping and being belligerent. These kind of people, they get off on it, you know?
Yeah, the attention. There's
very few people who call them out, you know?
Well...
I have no problem being that guy.
So, she seemed to be enjoying it. So that's a good thing. I mean, the heckler word, you know, makes me feel like she was giving you shit, but she was enjoying it. She was belligerent. And so, at a different venue, do you think that would be acceptable? Obviously, when there's more people.
Either she's a complete idiot and doesn't realize that she's disrupting a whole scene going on.
Sure.
Or she's getting off on it and she knows exactly what she's doing.
Attention seeker.
Yeah.
I love, she's a great girl, I think.
What do you think it was, JB?
I think it was
the red hair.
Probably a blend of both.
Yeah. Insanity and
she kind of knows Dan, the violin player in the band. She seems to like know him, I guess, and Dan is kind of like
super supportive.
Dan's just kind of this guy who like goes with the flow. He never calls anybody out. He just like, you know, he's the nicest guy in the world, and he's just there like egging her on. Like every time she cheers, he gets like more into it. She cheers harder, and like I'm looking at other people in the crowd and they're just like, oh my god, dude, I just came here for a quiet night of music and
instead I got two people getting off of a fiddle. And
I know, get a room.
It's Tuesday, come on. I mean, Frank would have never put up with that. Frank would have had her out in no time.
But the Texas Hill Road Band night was amazing. That was good awesome. Squad.
Good turnout.
Yeah.
No Edwards brothers.
No Edwards.
John, no call, no show.
Okay.
But it was good to see Gus. I haven't seen Gus in so long. It was treasure to catch up with him.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you had Omaya, Mario.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my boy Jeff Ryan, Drewski, Jeff obviously. Ryan,
yeah. Took me a while to realize that was Jeff, but yeah.
Oh, yeah, that slick new haircut.
Yeah.
You guys sounded sick, too.
Well, definitely awesome. Drewski was sick. He was very sick.
Yeah, he acted like it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he wasn't himself that night, and he sent the band, you know, the band has kind of a message thread, and he sent the band a message thread like a few days later, and he's like, I'm so sorry I wasn't as good as I could have been, guys. Like,
I don't know.
Drew, we didn't even notice, man. You fucking rocked.
If you listened to it, because you recorded the whole thing, right?
Yeah, I got the whole show on YouTube. The whole show.
Fun. Dope. Yeah, Jacob Bell showed me that. Definitely awesome.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know you had that up on YouTube.
Yeah, and I didn't.
It's only playing in Massachusetts.
Yeah, select is theaters.
Is it on the Dutch subscription or is it on?
No, it's on John Bonner.
John Bonner.
Mass theaters only.
And I was planning on it. It wasn't even me who recorded it. My bass player, Peter, recorded it with his camera equipment. And I was planning on doing that myself, but totally slipped my mind as we were like loading up the cars and leaving for the venue. I just left my camera shit. So I'm so glad he showed up with his thing. And like, we have that forever.
Oh, you know? Definitely. Yeah. Oh, your boy, Dave Bowman showed up too.
Bowman was there.
Angel voice just got married.
Yep. David just got married. Congratulations, David.
Voice of an angel.
David's a listener. He knows about the Dutch cast.
Oh yeah. Still with Boxy too, which I love.
Dude, I couldn't believe how pumped Kyle was about the podcast. He's like, I didn't even know about this. Like, I listened to every episode back to back, man. You guys need a freaking... Pete needs to get a new microphone, dude.
Everybody's been saying that for sure. Yeah.
It's unanimous.
Apparently, yeah.
Well, let's start a little GoFundMe or something, and I'll buy it.
Going to crowdsource it?
Yeah, I was gonna say it sounds. I think you can afford it, Pete.
I don't know. You're coming in pretty crisp and clear on the iPhone, though. Yeah, I like it. iPhone.
Yeah. No. I'll get it. I'll get it. I keep saying it, but I will.
I mean, even better for the viewers to mute you the whole time would actually be awesome as well. Save money. Bottom would have to edit.
Like a really good microphone. I've been listening to more podcasts since we've been like doing this thing, and Cauldron. I'm paying more attention to the production stuff.
Cauldron.
Cullen's podcast is fantastic.
Totally. Great
his,
guest.
His podcast, I listen to some more stuff. It's deep. It's hard. Like he has the link. He said he might drop in, but he's got a couple of pages to write in some writing screenplay.
Bring him in.
He's got the link. He said he's got to do some work with that screenplay, and then maybe he'll come in. I don't know.
I can't believe you guys haven't had your brother on. He's an interesting fellow.
He's down. He's down.
Yeah, he's on the list. He's in the queue.
He's down for the count.
We got him in the queue. We got Ryan Dixon in the queue. We got we got Tyrone Scott in the queue. Because Tyrone has a hell of an Instagram. I don't know if you guys know this.
Oh yeah,
he puts out some good content.
Oh, Bri, you gotta fucking find it.
We'll have to. I haven't seen my man in a long time.
I really want to get Kim back on the show.
You gotta. He's legit professional too.
Yeah,
I'm trying to think. Jack Burke, Cullen's brother, is a professional stand-up. A lot better than Kim back. Hopefully, Kim back sees us.
My cousin Mike would be hilarious.
He would. <Yeah. laughs> He would definitely be funny.
Yeah.
We just have him call in. Just have him on a like a landline.
Just to rip the two of you up a bunch?
No, I'm just going to send him a link. I'm going to like hide the link so it doesn't look like a Zoom call link. And I'm going to send it to him and be like, check this out.
Yeah.
And he'll be forced to like enter the waiting room. Or I don't need, I'd take the waiting room right off. So like you guys just appear. I don't have to like let anyone in or whatever.
Mm. I'm happy to be here.
Happy to have you, Brian.
Yeah, BT. So, Brian, you are a quasi host, but you are still a guest at this point. So we didn't cover a ton of Brian Terrill, the life of Brian Terrill.
But what would you say we covered in the first episode?
I don't think we covered much other than that factoid of you wanting to pitch the Waterworld universe to a studio to make a series of that.
And luckily, Colin saw that.
And a lot of our viewers really like that. Really like that. So
get out of here. 2 out of 3?
Yeah. There was like 2 people that said they liked it.
I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I mean, I think I don't think it's very far-fetched at all. I think it's very realistic.
Did you know Jack Black was in Waterworld?
Not I didn't true. Know that. Who's he in? What role does he have?
He's the gunner. He's one of the guys that's shooting the machine guns.
Is he?
Yes.
I don't think so.
Look it up.
Can I look it up live?
Yep. Look it up live.
I wonder if he can share his screen. IMDb app.
How about Jack Black and the Cable Guy?
Yeah.
That was like the first movie I ever saw, man.
Dude, he's so the man. Brian texted me last night. Brian texted me last night just Jack Black's on Wheel of Fortune. Celebrity. I clicked right over. I went right to it. He's the man. And he did great. He won.
Until the final. He lost in the final thing, though.
Oh.
No, because he did the fun and games or whatever.
Yeah.
He did make it to the final round. It was him, Cal Penn, and then I'm not sure what her name was, but a podcaster as well.
Yeah.
Has anyone ever won the $1 million wedge? Has anyone won that?
I don't think so.
I don't know.
You go bankrupt right after the next spin.
I'm looking that up. I'm looking that up.
So Pete, tell us about this.
But one of them was Crocs and socks, and Jack Black's like, I wear those all the time.
Or what was it?
One of the answers was Crocs and socks.
And that was a good one. And then there was another one. I forget what it was. It was
The Christmas leg, Christmas story.
Yeah. And it was full size Christmas
life leg. Size, life size went, leg lamp.
And, but he went, did he go full size instead of life size?
He got, he, no.
He went with,
oh, I forget.
It was something like, it was like one of the options. I think it was full size leg lamp was the actual answer. But he went with something that I actually thought in my head too at a time. I was like, oh no, that's wicked stupid. And then he actually went with that.
Yeah.
But whatever the actual answer was made sense, but his didn't really.
Yeah.
But no, he was a great guest. Cal Penn was a great guest. And unfortunately, I can't think of the girl's name that was on as a podcaster.
Okay, here we go.
What do you got?
Out of over 700,000 episodes, 3 people have made more than $1 million on Wheel of Fortune.
Wow. But I think Sajak is still, you know, using fake hair that he looks the same.
Yeah.
But he's old enough that the original Vanna White.
700,000. I'm sorry. It's 7,000.
7, all right. So 21,000 then. 21,000 guess. But yeah, it's Vanna White's daughter, I'm pretty sure, which is awesome.
Vanna White, yeah, she had a great run.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I thought Sajak, now with all hosts or any sort of reality TV, no matter what you do, there's going to be a nice, you know, you have to watch everything you say. So I'm pretty sure Sajak had some sort of incident not too long ago with a guest. Where he said something stupid.
Sajak?
On live TV. Yeah, he said something stupid on live TV. I don't know if it was to a celebrity or just a citizen guest, but said something, but
apparently he's still there. Survived. He's it. Not He's not completely canceled.
No, he's not. Well, people are coming back from cancellations. Kevin Spacey just got his first movie.
Oh, he did?
Louis C.K. is coming to Boston, and
Louis C.K., yeah.
he's been producing other people's stuff.
Yeah.
Obviously, like Cosby, Weinstein,
They're done.
they're done.
obviously, yeah, for
Yeah.
sure. But I think people are like accepting Louis C.K. a little bit more. Spacey's thing is not in America. Well, I'm
Yeah.
saying, yeah. Is that Norman gonna bring him up or what?
Yeah, he's here. Doing well.
Kevin Spacey is oh man. He was one of my favorites.
It's a
And then I
bummer.
heard about
So
all that
good.
shit with like Richard Dreyfuss's son and all that, like
I mean, top two Spacey movies. What would you say? As an actor, not as a
Oh,
pedophile.
American Beauty is right in there.
Yeah.
And he was in
Glenn Larry.
Glenn
Glenn
Ross,
Gary
right?
was. Of course he was.
But
The Negotiator. I like.
Negotiator, yep.
And what's in the box?
Seven.
Detective Seven.
Seven, yep.
Yeah,
Yeah, like
minor role though.
I'd have to go
Right?
Seven and American Beauty. Those are my two for Kevin Spacey.
I think his role in Seven is like Hopkins in Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah.
13 minutes total, something like that. Anthony Hopkins won the Oscar, whatever it was, for Silence of the Lambs. Spacey is in Seven for like 2 seconds and a scary, scary villain for
Yeah, oh
sure.
yeah.
What is it? Gwyneth Paltrow is Pitt's wife, whose head is in the box.
Yeah, it's Gwyneth.
He's an
What's in the
incredible
Young Gwyneth?
impressionist too.
Oh yeah, I
Oh,
know.
so good.
Definitely.
He can do Johnny Carson like perfect. Gets the mouth going too. Right.
House of Cards. He was phenomenal too. Yeah.
I watched a couple episodes of that. I didn't really hang with it, but it's a good
Good
show.
show. Good, very, very good show for sure.
Yeah,
I watched a few
he's good,
seasons.
man. He's a good actor.
What happened after they canceled him to House of Cards?
They so they
Danny?
had no they had the Are you familiar with it at all?
Enough. I mean, I think I got to like season three or four. So they were like senators and stuff. Does he get to the top? Is he president?
I mean, he ends up being president
Yeah.
before he gets canceled. So then, if I'm not mistaken, because I stopped watching, his wife, Robin Wright Penn,
That's what I
or
mean,
Robin
Robin
Wright,
Wright.
becomes president. And then I'm pretty sure his boy, Dougie Stamper, who was his head of staff, becomes president too. But
No shit. That
I didn't
guy that
watch, I didn't watch beyond that, so I really don't know. The less I
Dude,
remember.
that show was the first season where what I
Zoe
thought was
Kravitz.
going, yeah, well, I thought she was a lifer, like, she was a main character throughout the whole season.
Or when
Whack.
Dougie's shooting taking shots through his eye too. Do you recall that?
I don't recall that. I just remember him throwing her into the train, and that was like, holy shit.
Based on a true story. That's why Space that's why Spacey got canceled, not because of the molesting inebriated boys. He pushed Zoe Barnes in front of a train.
Richard Dreyfuss's son, dude.
I didn't hear about that.
Yeah, Richard
What?
Dreyfuss's son, like Richard Dreyfuss was in like London and Kevin Spacey was living there and they like ha had like a lunch meeting, and he brought his kid with him. I was think he was like 15, like 14. And the kid sat next to him at like the table they were at, and he was like feeling him up from under the table and shit.
Get out of here.
And
What?
the kid didn't come out about it until like years later.
Of course.
And Kevin Spacey pretty much caved and admitted to it.
And so far, he's won all his cases. That's why he just got his new movie role, which I believe was out of London. You see this banner?
Nope. Latte Larry's. Nice.
Nice.
Mocha Joe's. That's what Pete should be wearing.
Yeah, I was looking at some Larry merch shit. I think the Instagram that I follow for that is Curb Your Curb. Larry David, it's called.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
This is a Gus Christmas gift.
I want the coffee mug that says fucking Mocha Joe's on it.
I want the coffee table book that's Kramer's.
Oh, of course. Yeah. I was just watching something book. About the real guy that it's based on. Mm-hmm. Like Larry's actual like old neighbor that he used to have. His name's Kramer and everything.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
Oh, Kramer? Yeah. Yeah, and this guy just rides it, like milks it so hard, dude. Like for a while he had a business in New York City, like a roadside like business, like I'm the real Kramer, come take a picture with the real Kramer, and he hustled that shit, man. He milked it.
Just like Kramer would.
Yeah.
Just like Kramer would. He wouldn't want to get a real job.
Yeah.
Cuz Kramer never had a job. Right?
No, Kramer always had a He always had business interests. All business interests only.
Well, he worked in the bagel factory before they went under.
And I don't even work here. That's what makes this so difficult.
That's what he brings the briefcase full of crackers.
Oh, it's so funny.
But then when he comes back to the bagel factory that he went on strike for 12 years.
Oh, yeah, that's what it was.
And then he quits again, and he's like, Skibs! Skip.
That's what it was.
That clip keeps going around like social media reels of him chugging the beer with the cigarette.
Mhm.
It's like here's to having a good life or whatever. And he just chugs the beer and he's still got the cigarette going and he lets out a huge burp afterward and the smoke comes out.
Here's to feeling good all priceless. The time. Yeah, I think it's here's to feeling good all the time.
Here's to feeling good all the time.
Because the accountant is allergic to moose hair, so he thinks they're just doing cocaine in the bathroom or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Right. Here's to feeling good all the time.
Oh, yeah.
And the scentless booze, whatever he had launched.
I never like, talked about.
Yeah, okay. It was another.
I saw him in a movie.
It was like
Hennigan's.
Hennigan's.
You could walk around drunk all day and no one would know.
I saw him in a movie recently that we were watching. Do you remember that Mike Myers movie? So I Married an Axe Murderer?
Definitely. Kid Pants Now? Definitely.
With the Scottish father and the fucking, the kids. Sketchy fucking wife. Keep saying it to him, and then Michael Richards like loses it on him, like spazzes out on him. Like, I'm a bad person, okay.
Which is ironic years down the road for sure.
Yeah.
Michael Richards.
And he's in Problem Child. He's the villain in Problem Child with the bow tie.
He's in Airheads. He's in the radio station crawling through the vents and stuff like that.
Doug.
Mm-hmm.
Doug Beach. That's his name, Doug Beach.
Pistol, how has Willow been, the series so far?
It's
Don't tell me too much.
I haven't started.
I won't tell you anything about the story itself. I'll just say there's some comedic relief and then there's a comedy, right? And the script is just like one-liner joke after one-liner joke. And maybe they're just trying to do that to be a little bit different than all the freaking Dragons and Castle shows out there that are uber serious. And they're just trying to soften it up a little bit, but it's like they went too far. Like, it's like, you don't even take Willow seriously. Like, it's like, it's pretty, I don't know.
Doesn't the whole sound story, good.
I agreed. Yeah. Come out
it's
with
not
it.
Good. Did you watch the movie beforehand? I don't have to, man. I got that memorized in my head. I don't. It's just a totally different story. It's like there's these like goblin creatures. It's not like a Wicked Witch. It's a totally different thing. The only thing that's consistent is the queen is that redheaded princess grown up.
Yeah.
Mad Mardigan's wife. Mad Mardigan's not hasn't been in it. Now I know Val Kilmer can't obviously be in it, but he was in Top Gun. But anyway, so I don't know where Mad Mardigan is. They haven't really clarified where he is, but they have two kids, and one of the daughters is gay. Like, that's fine. It's just there's a lot of what's that?
So you're pissed?
No, I'm not pissed. I'm just saying like that, there's, I don't know. There's just social things thrown in a lot lately and it's fine. I'm not against it. There's not anything wrong with that. You know, my father's gay, you know, but she's gay. And then, the brother is dating this girl that is a muffin maker, but she's really a Laura Dan.
Is that another word for?
No, she literally is a baker. She makes like muffins, and she's
I thought you were being homophobic again.
No, I'm not homophobic. I'm not. I'm just saying, like, they just like they don't have to.
So, how well do they, you know, go? Are how faithful are they to the movie? As far as the people that grew up watching it are like our age. Or maybe even older. Yeah. And I feel like a lot of these shows that come out kind of try to cater to like younger kids in a way.
They do. So then maybe that's what they're doing. So the script and the content is catered towards a younger crowd. And then they throw in things that we would recognize.
Yeah.
Like Willow looking at the bones to find out where to go next.
Like the Addams Family one that just came out too. Wednesday. It's like the same Wednesday. Thing.
Yeah. Pechanga.
Yeah.
Pechanga, so, baby.
It's very catered to teens and shit.
Sure. But it's nothing, I mean.
That's not who's going to watch the series, though. So why are they doing that?
Mm-hmm.
The people who are going to try to watch the series are the people who grew up loving the movie and watching the movies.
Right. Like, the people that, like, really like Top Gun obviously were fans of the original Top Gun. These younger kids that I've seen, they're like, yeah, Top Gun was okay. The old one sucked. It's like, you don't get it, you know?
Yeah, you don't get it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, what you saw was a sequel. It's not they see a lot of remakes, too. And I'm like, you know, there have been a few instances where I said to Julian, like, yeah, you know they made this one before, right? Like, no, there's an original. I'm like, and I point him in the direction twice of the original.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not a lot of original thought going on. And it has to do with the predictability of the revenue, right? Nostalgia can predict a certain amount of revenue brought in by a certain. Yeah.
Yeah. And
but still, like, take a chance.
Well, it's a safe bet for studios because they know the idea worked once, so it'll work again.
Mm-hmm.
And that just shows me that either there aren't good writers coming in with ideas, or the scouts that are in charge of analyzing and going through all these scripts aren't competent either. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would beg to differ, man, that no one is sending in good scripts to Hollywood, man. I'm sure there are great scripts that just go overlooked because the wrong people are in charge, or they don't have balls. They don't want to see something raw on the screen. They want to cater to a popular taste. And yeah, I mean, I unless you're Quentin Tarantino or fucking Scorsese, I feel like you've got a slim shot at doing something with some cutting edge nowadays, you know?
Yeah.
Step it up, Pete. Come on.
Work on my
scripts. I gotta write something.
About Pete.
I've started a lot of screenplays. I just never finished them.
I've written a lot of stuff about Pete. Just about who he is.
What kind of shit, Bri? Like poems? Like love poems?
Oh, I start with that.
What do you talk about? What I mean?
It always ends in one sentence. Pete Edwards went to St. John's. Pete Edwards is a private school kid. And then I just can't write anymore.
You are the only person I know that still talks about that shit, Brian. I mean,
what about
We're 35 years old. You're still giving me shit about what high school I went to.
Yeah.
Where'd you go again?
I went to St. John's.
Yep. And it saved your ass up in New Hampshire with when you flashed that ID.
That's not...
Yeah, man.
That guy didn't know what St. John's was, though. Ooh. I mean, I don't think
he didn't know you were gonna kick
his
ass.
He didn't know
what St. He wasn't like, oh, St. John's, you must be a good kid. He was a New Hampshire statey. He was a super trooper. He was high out of his mind. No, he wasn't. We were.
Bored. He was probably bored out of his mind.
Bored out of his mind. Yeah. Bored out of his mind. And that was a very super trooper-ish day.
I was like, can't pull over
any further. Because the cop was definitely bored. The way in which you got arrested was very strange. The way in which I drove the car behind you to the police station was very strange.
To the place.
I was just wondering
where the cops work.
Dude, how about that clip of from Ninja Turtles that I shared today? What was Splinter's actual line, though? Coming from where? He says something else. He says coming, which is funny, but he says something else after that. And
that what was Ninja Turtles was that? Because that was a different April O'Neil.
That was...
Was that two?
Secret of the Ooze. Yeah, Secret of the Ooze.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought the original April O'Neil, who is the top, she was smoking hot.
Yeah, she was hot.
She was
hot. Yeah. That clip of her, like, squinting her eye.
Oh, my God. We, like, paused it.
From the original, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Jeez, the things you remember.
Yeah. Yeah.
Put those away.
Yeah, that we watched that one a lot. And Varsity Blues. I don't want your life.
This was pre-online, so pre-online, like, porn. So if a movie had, like, a pair of tits in it, it was like, oh, my God.
Yeah, it was a big deal. Yeah.
Yeah.
fucking, you know, Lord of the Rings. I always watch my whole family watched Star Wars since I can remember.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of sports in your house when we were at your house. A lot of KE watching sports.
A lot of football.
Watching some sports with KE.
Mm-hmm.
But the extensive VHS collection in the basement.
We still have it, and we are building upon the VHS collection. Did you know that?
No.
We're still building on that and putting there all the Cape. Our Cape house has, like, classic 80s VHSs. I buy them on, like, Etsy and stuff like that for $2 to $3. Mm-hmm. But we get classics like, I mean, we get 90s classics like Congo, Air Force One, Gump. We get Face Off or Con Air. So we have like that 90s stuff, but then we got 80s stuff like Look Who's Talking,
Back to the Future, fucking
Back to the Future, Weird Science. I'm trying to think of some other classics.
Breakfast Club.
We don't have Breakfast Club, but
I have kind of a weird story about VHS. When I was living in Burlington with Gus years ago, we had a VCR, and we bought a bunch of VHSs at a store nearby or whatever. And yeah, they were mad cheap, $1, $2. And we had a copy of The Jerk with Steve Martin.
Mm-hmm.
And do you know that scene in the movie where he, like, uncontrollably his body starts moving when he hears music and he doesn't know what's happening to him, like, what is this that I'm doing, like, and people have to explain to him that he's, like, dancing. The song that plays on the VHS.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a Lawrence Welk TV show tune kind of thing. But when I watched it years later on DVD, totally different song.
Really?
Ah, yeah. So, and I, in the original song, kind of like, I liked it. So that's why I was like,
well, you remembered it.
You know, I, when I bought the DVD of The Jerk, I'm like, ah, can't wait to hear the song again and figure out what it is, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I, it was a totally different song. So now I'm on the hunt for a VHS of The Jerk.
Okay.
So I can find that
check
song.
Check Etsy and check, like, I don't know, like Facebook Marketplace and stuff like that. But there's places that have VHSs that you can get.
Mm-hmm.
But no, why do you think they did that? Do you think maybe they took the song from someone that then probably said
yeah,
you shouldn't?
Yeah, I mean, a copyright issue may have come up.
Yeah.
That happens a lot in the mm-hmm. industry. Intellectual property, and sometimes people forget to register certain songs properly when they're published, when they're released. And then years later, once they talk to a lawyer, an entertainment lawyer who knows mm-hmm. the industry in and out, they'll tell them, mm-hmm. hey, you forgot to do this, you forgot to do this, you forgot to do this. And then they'll go back and like button up all those loose ends. And then
a different song comes up.
Everything kind of works yeah. itself out. And like, oh, we can't use this song anymore, so let's put a different one in for the DVD
yeah.
release.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's my guess as to what happened, but yeah, it's interesting, man. You know, when I first you know, met back up with my dad, and my dad was very, he had a production company, and he, you know, copyrighted everything that he wrote, recorded, you know, lyrics, anything. And he stressed that importance to me strongly, mm-hmm. like register all your songs,
mm-hmm.
because, you know, it's not out of the realm of possibility that, you know, if I release some music, that it will get heard by someone who
sure.
wants to put it in a commercial or whatever, mm-hmm. play it on the radio. All that shit is tracked by what they mm-hmm. call performance rights organizations, PROs.
Okay.
And they basically control all the the royalties that go to the songwriters,
how do
publishers,
they know,
and musicians.
Because how do they know it's been played?
Yeah, when you have a radio station, for instance, every single song that you play on your program is tracked, logged, and filed with these performance
sure.
rights
sure.
organizations,
with the artists or with them too. Yeah.
Yeah. And so it helps everyone get paid. You know, even if you played a horn on one of those recordings, you're going to see residual from that
mm.
because of these PROs going around making sure everything's, you know, buttoned up and shit. And a lot of these music venues are getting in trouble, because under the statute and the law, they don't really have to be recordings. If there are musicians performing in your establishment that are
mm-hmm.
covering songs
mm-hmm.
of, that are covering songs that are registered with
mm-hmm.
these PROs, they could face big fines if they're not paying out. You know, a lot of the venues that we work with pay out.
Sure.
They pay that license.
Okay.
So they can have cover bands play there.
Gotcha.
But we play in a couple other, you know, seedier places that don't really pay the license. And these are the places that have been getting kind of in trouble over the years.
Mm-hmm.
I know Smokestack, that barbecue place that Reno worked at for a while, they got in trouble for that. Someone came in, kind of like ghosted them, like just acted like a customer and
yeah,
hung out at the bar and watched an act and
yeah,
made notes of every fucking song that was played there and
yeah,
told them, I want to see your license, you know, for,
yeah.
So it's definitely a lot, you know, we don't really get to see that aspect of owning a venue and like having entertainment play there.
Sure. You know? Sure.
Cause they're, you know, unless you want to perform original music, that's fine. And that's how a lot of places kind of get around it is like, yeah, you know, they host a songwriter night or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Come through, singer original songs. They can't get in any trouble.
Mm-hmm. Now,
Worcester, Mass isn't like a huge target for that. But if you're in L.A.
But I was in, you know, I was at Tin Roof last night.
Nashville.
Nashville. So Tin Roof probably has all these licenses to allow for these people to cover.
All those PRO's offices are in Nashville.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Go on, sorry. What were you saying?
I was just saying that those bars that I went to have the license so that people can play what they want.
They all do. All yeah. Those places in Nashville are licensed, guaranteed.
They have to be. Like these yeah. These people are, you know, they're screaming for all the old, I don't know, last night was a lot of Garth Brooks, which I like. I like Garth Brooks. I'm not a country fan, but I respect Garth Brooks.
I like that one song. I like the Friends in Low Places.
Friends in Low Places, yeah. Yeah, that's a good one. He's got a couple other good ones, but, you know, there's a lot of people. There's a lot of bad musicians too here too. You know, they're like everyone's great. It's like not everyone's great.
Yeah. For sure.
There was this girl last night that was singing, and it wasn't pretty. Maybe I'm just too old for that bar because I went for the company and I took some of my employees there after a nice Italian dinner, but I was like the old guy there.
What place is this? Where'd you go?
Well, we went to dinner at Giovanni's Restaurante, which is near. They put in a Virgin hotel in Midtown. Yeah, it's like kind of swanky. So this was right next to that Virgin hotel. But Midtown, Winners and Losers. Losers caught on fire, mm-hmm. and they have to Losers' ceiling fell down, and they have to remake Losers. We were at Winners after Tin Roof, you know, these bars, the red room. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I remember Winners and Losers for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Over the river and through the hood to East Nashville, we go.
Yeah. East.
Yeah. I really loved living there when I lived there. There's been so much development that's gone down since I lived there. But since I moved back, I've visited there twice or just once? I think just once.
Twice. Twice, wedding was once.
Yeah, once for your wedding and then once with Marissa as we were traveling.
So your cousins in New York. And you saw your cousins in North Carolina. Did you go to Ash?
Yeah. So for your, there's a whole like YouTube video about your wedding, like me, the time leading up to your wedding.
Yes.
I showed up like a week early just so I could hang out with Drew and just hang out in Nashville and catch up in Nashville. And then, I stayed there like a week before the wedding.
Yeah.
I stayed there a whole week before the wedding. That was a great rundown. I just drove by myself. I had the mattress in the back of the Subaru, crashing like rest stops, and I think I stayed with Evdog. I stayed with Evdog in Philadelphia on my way down, and my cousin Missy, who lived in Mooresville at the time, North Carolina, Mooresville. It's more closer to Charlotte than Raleigh, but then came to Tennessee and stayed with Drew for like 4 days, and then it was your wedding weekend.
Wife went to Florida with her friends. She just went to the airport for a weekend away. So it's just me and Ethan this weekend. And
Wow, just holding it down with Ethan.
yeah.
Nice.
Good. I'm happy for her. Like, she needs to do that. You need to do those things. Like, we needed like our trip to California. Like, it's healthy. Like, you need to have balance. You can't just be a mom, be working, put your head down, do the freaking thing. Like, you
Right.
gotta get your time in with your boys. You gotta do that. It's important.
Yeah.
That's what this kind of is. Like we were saying, that's what this kind of is.
Well, this is, yeah, I mean, this is the best we can do. It's the bare minimum, you know, given our
Yeah.
distance, but
Yeah.
we get it done.
So John and I drive up on the 21st. We're gonna go because John's flying down next week. Next Friday's my birthday. And he's flying down and we're gonna hang out here for a couple days, and then he and I are driving north to Massachusetts. So we're doing the trip like you did.
Oh,
But we're
nice.
gonna meet, yeah, but it's gonna be a nice little brother thing, and we're gonna bring my dog. We're gonna hit up some small towns that I've found when I've been taking this trip, but we're gonna stay west. We're gonna stay away from the city. So instead of going like up towards the coast, going to DC, Baltimore, Philly, New York, up to Massachusetts, we're gonna stay like west of the Appalachians, right? And then cut over north of Manhattan. It's basically 81 all the way,
Yeah, I know 81. I've taken that way a couple times, Pete.
But we're gonna hit up Gettysburg. Yeah, that
Yeah,
podcast with
you
Cullen,
should.
that podcast with Cullen got me turned on to like these different battles. And I was texting with Cullen, and Cullen was saying you should get to Gettysburg around dusk, and it's just like this hallowed ground, and it's like there's this energy, man. It's something to see. So
Nice.
I'm looking forward to that, and like meditating or something, or enjoying myself a little bit there. I'll see if it's spooky, and if my dog starts barking or acting weird, then maybe it is
Yeah.
really spooky. But so and then Melissa flies in after that. So Melissa and Ethan are gonna fly in, and my mom and sister are gonna pick them up at the airport, and then they're gonna fly out a little bit earlier because John and I are headed to the fish show. So you should be proud of me. I'm going to my first fish show bar,
Where are you seeing him?
New Year's Eve, Madison Square Garden.
Oh, okay, I did that last year. It's fun,
John said
man.
it's amazing.
Yeah, it's fun. But we were supposed to do meet Trevor got us tickets. Trevor is on speaking terms with the band. You know
Really?
that. Yeah, I mean
No.
Mike Gordon, the bass player from
Yeah.
Fish, he goes to Trevor's restaurant like twice a week and just
Wow.
hangs out on his laptop and looking big supporter of all his vegan Thanksgivings that he does every year, Trevor. And
No
so
shit.
yeah, Trevor invites us like to the show. He's like, I think I can get us tickets, like really good seats for Madison Square. And he got one extra seat for me. And I'm like, can you get Marissa down on it? Because originally Marissa thought she would have to work on New Year's Eve, and then all of a sudden it like freed up for her. So she's like, do you think you can ask Trevor to ask Mike for like one more ticket? And I'm like, yeah, I guess. And he not only did Mike give us or get us another ticket, he sends Trevor an email response saying, yeah, here's a yeah, I'll give you guys four tickets, and you know what? You've been so good to me, your restaurant and stuff. It's on the house.
No shit.
You guys will be in the family and friends section, like five rows back to the right from the main stage, with like
Wow.
everyone's fan. We were with like all the band members'
The
family, and
family.
like
Yeah.
it was wild, dude. We were supposed to be there on New Year's Eve, but it got cut
This was
because
last
of
year.
COVID. Yeah, COVID cut it off. So they did a redo for 420 Madison Square, and we all just got an Airbnb and like went to the redo show, and it was a blast, dude. It was so much
Dude,
fun.
that's awesome.
Yeah,
That's
you'll
awesome,
have so
man.
much fun. They always do something like interesting for New Year's Eve. Like they always have like a theme or like a big production. Like this year they had whales and dolphin drones like just flying through, and they were playing the song Waves during it, and you know, we taking a little mushroom chocolate, you know, fucking just loving everything, dude. It was, it was so great. You know?
Yeah.
That was my first time seeing the band. It's my first time seeing the band in full. You know, I've seen different configurations of the band, but never Fish. So it was awesome.
Well, John's got tickets for every night, and but I'm going to be going on, the, I think, the 30th or the 29th. So not New Year's Eve, New Year's Eve. It's the one of the shows prior to New Year's Eve. And then I don't know who's going with him. I know Kevin Stanislawczyk is going to be there. We were texting, and we're going to go over to their house after Christmas to see Lo and their kids. And we're up there. We haven't solidified what we were going to do when I'm up there, but the Dutch were trying to do something, right? Whether it's just a get together at like a bar or Vincent's or
Christmas,
whatever.
Vincent's opens at like 7 on Christmas Day, so I think we should all just like meet there, make it easy.
Okay,
where everyone can come to Bonner residence and
we'll
just paint that whole house red.
Man, Christmas at 45 Lake.
Well, yeah, the 45 Lake Street. I mean, all of our houses were so legendary.
Yeah.
But more so mine and like D-Mall's. And in yours, the basement at Irita.
That had character.
Oh, my God. It was so boxed in. So, like, when you would pass out in there, when you would pass out in there, like, you'd wake up the next morning and just be like, how long did I fucking sleep? What the fuck time is it right now? And he'd open the garage door and realize it's like morning, like fresh morning.
Brian.
Hello.
Wow. Thanks for joining us.
Welcome back.
We're just talking about how when you passed out at Pete's house back in the day in Irita Road, it was just total blackout. Like
just, it was just a blackout.
Had no idea what time it was when you woke up, where you were, anything.
Well, for me, that was way back in the day, though.
One time they couldn't find Steven, and he was sleeping in there. Remember that? Everyone thought Steven vaguely was missing. Yeah. Steven was missing, and
that's right,
he was sleeping down there.
His family was like worried about him. His family was worried about him, and like they were in touch with us, and we had no idea that he was there either. Like, it was just like a big catastrophe.
And my parents were home when they like called down or something. And they're like, he didn't answer. There's no one down there. But I remember when we'd walk upstairs, my dad would be at the kitchen tables on like cigarette number 8, right? And he would always be like, "You just getting in or just getting up?" Be like, it varied every time. Sometimes we're just getting in.
Both you guys' houses, you know, Bry's, like, were very similar in layout.
Same layout. Same layout.
Yeah.
Bry's was just like 2X. 3X.
Yeah, it was like a little bit larger.
Very larger.
I mean, 7 kids. What are you going to do?
7 kids.
7,000 kids.
Wow. 7 kids. That's like 7 college tuitions. Fucking.
7.
Millions of dollars, Bri, to raise all you guys.
7. Mm-hmm. A lot of interruptions, and then maybe you're friends with people like Pete.
That stays there.
Oh.
And that's Pete, 8. Pete originally, like, your original house, Pete, was kind of near Bry, right?
Mm-hmm.
Beverly Hill Drive.
My rental on Lake Street.
Lake Street.
Was it Lake Street?
No, that's Oak Street.
So that rental house was awesome. But before that was Gleason Road, and that was with Kyle Howe and Cullen.
Yeah. There were a lot of people on fucking Beverly Hill Drive. A lot of people.
It was a neighborhood to remember. It was Ladowski, Padovano, DeAngelis,
Gentilly,
Lynch, Jesse Lewis
didn't live there.
Yes, he did.
Yeah, he did.
Oh, I thought he lived over by Edgemere.
So he. He initially started at Beverly Hills. The entire Beverly Hills compound used to be a farm owned by Jesse Lewis's family.
Oh.
Oh, really?
Huh.
I didn't know that.
So it used to be an entire farm, and then everyone bought their like plots of land. So no, we grew up with Jesse for sure.
Look what I bought the other day.
Ooh. Long cut?
Bosh. No, Bosch always went thin cut.
What turned you on to that, Bonner? Just a hard work day?
I had a long like work day.
And, yeah.
I don't know. It was just kind of like an impulse buy.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't bought dip in like 5 years, but it was just kind of like a impulse. Maybe I'll just throw a dip in while I clean 57 windows in a row.
Yeah.
Like.
I'll get a tin every now and again. It's usually when I have like a long project or work day ahead.
Yeah. And it kind of gives you more energy and
focus, little kick.
Yeah.
What would the Lord say?
What did the Lord say? What is this prayer? Sunday prayer?
Yeah, I'm saying for Pete. What would the Lord say by you? You know,
I'm not that religious,
Pete.
My son's not baptized yet.
Until I get down.
Did you christen him?
So you finally set it up. So he's going to be christened in February. So he'll be 2 years old to his christening. Now that's late. I'm going up to Massachusetts to be there at the 23rd for my sister's son's christening. So, and Ethan's over a year older than little Johnny. So yeah, he's a little heathen. We haven't gone to church in a while, Bri.
Who's the godfather for Julie's kid?
Me.
Her brother. Jeremy, her brother. Oh wait, no, Julie's kid?
Julie's kid, who's the godfather?
Right here.
Yeah.
Right here. You're looking at him.
You're looking at him.
I'm the godfather to Jonathan Jr. Jonathan Massett Jr. Quite a step down. to have a bloodline like that, and you're pretty much royalty.
I'm a godfather. Jr. I'm a godfather. Mike's first son, AJ.
You're a stepfather. You're a stepfather too.
Yeah, pretty much, dude. Pretty much.
Pretty much. You definitely are.
I had to be a stepfather today, dude. I'll tell you.
Yeah, tell me what happened today.
You're almost a father. Man.
Well, the kids, you know, the kids started getting into marijuana and whatever.
What a bad person.
Him and his, you know, me and his mom have told him, like, that's fine. Like, we're not going to tell you not to do it and, like, shit on you if you do it. But, like, you know, don't do it here, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know. Go for a walk like we used to do and make it happen. Figure it out. Don't do it here because, you know, there's no chance of it happening, but we could get in trouble. How does that work? You're the one that's doing it there, though, too. You know? Anyway,
what's that, Bonner?
I caught him and his girlfriend, like, smoking outside.
So he's got a girlfriend.
He's got a girlfriend, yep. But, you know, they're just smoking out on the front stoop, and I just kind of, like, poke my head around the corner. I'm like, hey, guys, what are you doing? They're like, hi, and I'm like, I can't believe I have become this person who has to do this.
What do you say next?
I'm like, you know you're not supposed to be doing that here. Take a walk. I go, take a walk. And they're like, all right, sorry. I was, you know, really cool about it or whatever. And I come upstairs like 20 minutes later and they're on their hands and knees in the living room with carpet cleaner, cleaning up. They tracked in fucking like dirt and like dog shit from the yard on our white living room rug. Just like destroyed. And, you know, Julian's like scrambling to find like cleaner. And I'm like, dude, what are you doing, man? And I told him, like, this is what you need. Do not scrub it. Dab it. I'm like, dab it. Do you know what a dab is? And like, yeah, I think so. Dab it, dude. Do not scrub that shit. And, you know, it's the bad it's situation. Just a little back talk from him, you know.
But, what kind of back talk? What'd he say to you? I got
it. He's just like, you know, I don't know why you're so mad at me, man. And I'm just like, dude, like, it's because you're disrespectful, dude. It's because you're disrespectful and you're not really like thinking about anyone but yourself right now. And, you know, I've told you not like, to like smoke weed here and you smoke weed here. And like,
sounds like Pete. Then sounds like Pete.
Track in all this shit and then whatever.
I got years before this.
So then I sent a text to him. I'm like, I'm, you know, I'm going to be taking off in a little bit. I gotta run some errands. So Alex, his girlfriend, you know, she needs to get a ride home or I'm happy to drop her off or whatever, because he's not allowed to have a girl here, but no one's here. That's his mom's rule.
Okay.
Fair enough.
So, yeah, I'm taking off in a half hour. You know, if Alex needs a ride home, I'm happy to give it to her. And he's like, no, you know, she'll get picked up or whatever. And she comes down, I'm in the garage and, you know, she comes through the garage to leave and she's like, okay, bye. And there's no car like in the driveway. So I see her like walk up the driveway, cross the street into no man's land.
Yeah. What's across the street?
One of Julian's friends lives across the street, you know, his good friend, and they hang out there sometimes. I'm like, okay, maybe she's going over to Grace's house and like she got picked up there.
No.
So I'm in the clear. So now I can go to the hardware store and find the part I need for the fucking laundry door in the closet or whatever. And they don't have the part. So I go back home. And when I pull in the driveway, the garage door is open. And I walk into the garage and there's no one in there, but there's two chairs right by my workbench where the heater is.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, okay. All right. So then I hear the garage door open and it's Julian and he walks into the garage and I'm like, what's up, man? It's like, you know, we were just like chilling in here for a minute. And I'm like, yeah, you don't chill in here, dude. This is my domain. The garage is my domain. Take a walk. Take a hike. I'm like, oh, okay.
Motherfucker.
So, you know, not only did he like, you know, it was like the double transgression theory or whatever you call it. He's already in trouble, so he doesn't care if he gets in trouble again. Like, I don't know, man. Just trying to deal with it, you know. I think he's a great kid, for the most part, but he's a teenager, and I remember being a teenager, and I've reached an age, I guess, finally, where they're like fucking annoying to me. And I honestly get where my parents were coming from. I have way more respect for Dave, my stepdad.
Yes, and you become Dave.
Yeah, I mean, I'll never be Dave, but, you know, yeah.
Dave is a great man.
Dave just recently retired, like full-blown retired.
Congrats.
He was doing
some... What did he do? I don't even know what he did. Was he was an
in
engineer?
Logistics. Like he was in logistics for like medical supplies and shit like that. Like he'd run all the trucking going out, coming in.
Yep.
Did that for years. Yeah, he made good money doing it too.
Yeah. Well, he was always building those helicopters and planes. I thought he was an engineer.
He was always a hobbyist.
Yeah,
that's what good. Dave is a hobbyist.
That's good, man. It's a healthy
and
lifestyle.
Now he just grows weed. That's his new hobby. Just grows weed out of the house.
And distills whiskey.
He was doing the whiskey for a while, but I don't know. Whiskey takes time.
Whiskey's that's hard. Yeah.
Whiskey takes like 7 years for like one bottle of whiskey to start to taste good. You need to store it in a wooden cask for at least 7 years. Otherwise, all you have is pure gasoline, dude. It just burns to shit. Moonshine.
There was a whiskey on the menu last night at the restaurant that was distilled in 1855. The cost of it was $6,000. I don't know whether that was a glass or whatever it was, a bottle.
The cost of it?
$6,000.
Oh, it must have been the bottle.
I hope so. Wow. Yeah. It's got to be the bottle. But, I mean, that's old. That's pre-Civil War. I wonder what it tastes like. I guess it tastes better and better. Does it get better and better and better and better? Is that the way it goes?
Well, there's aging in the cask, the barrel, and then there's aging in the bottle,
which isn't as good.
I don't know. I'm not an expert in that field.
Less than 1 minute.
Less really? Than 1 minute?
Well, wrap I don't it know up. What you guys, let's wrap it up because I'm about to pass out. Was out late last night at Tin Roof.
Yeah, you should get some rest there, Peter.
I know. Well, Bri, good to have you.
Yeah, it's good to have you, Bri.
Brian Terrill.
I'll talk to you in the near future, bro.
I hope so. It has been a blessed evening talking to you guys, as always.
All right, guys. Steal your face right off of your head. Have a good night.
Peace out.
Cheers.